Good afternoon, dear traders, and today it's going to be our short webinar about the style of trading. Before I basically go to every single style that exists out there in the trading world, I will start with myself, how basically I came to the industry. I came to the industry in 1998 as a day trader, but I came basically early as the helper of a stockbroker, so I've been in the industry for over 20 years. This year, it's going to be over 20 years. In 1991, in the trading world, we're not talking about the day trading. We're talking about just the trading world, where there used to be just the big companies, Goldman Sachs, Morgan Stanley, Oppenheimer, and everywhere else, slowly walked in day trading. In 1991, first companies started to offer day trading for the people who will put the money into the account and start trading. After that, these people would get the license, Series 7 license, and then you can basically work for the company and become a professional trader. And the most important thing, if you did very well, the company would offer to you a very large leverage. It started somewhere about 1991, 1992, some companies begin in 1990. So the whole 90s, this industry was slowly but started booming. Because, you know, everybody would figure it out that day trading is the excellent choice to make money for the individual, because not everybody wants to sit home, not everybody wants to work, especially not to work for anybody. So the day trading, you know, slowly but surely started acquiring the place of the world as far as the a good job. You know, what really was amazing that when I got into the industry in 1998, my ex-boss used to hire people only with a very high GPA, 395, 390 and above from the top colleges. When I came to the industry in 1998, the company what I used to work for, the name of the company, it's WorldCo, it's no secret. I'm a licensed person, got my license in 1998. So when I started working at WorldCo, my boss used to hire only like top guys from the top colleges. What was really amazing, you know, I could never understand why, but a lot of people from a good colleges, we're talking about Columbia, we're talking about Stanford, we had a few people from the Stern Business School, from Yale University, Massachusetts. So basically those people with a very excellent education and spending a lot of money those years for education will come to a day trading firm and choose a job of nothing. You know, because you understand one thing for a fact, when you start trading, when you start trading, the most important thing is, of course, obviously to make money. And the biggest problem in trading, when you work, you don't know, you know, what are you gonna make, how much you're gonna make when you finish the college, and if especially if it's a good college, and after you finish the college and you go get a job, at least you get something, at least you get paid, you can go and build your career in your industry. But when you come to a trading, you don't know what's going to happen to you within 2 years, 3 years, or 4 years. So, you know, I was really pretty much amazed. You know, I could never compare myself. I was just a plain guy, used to be a taxi driver, had a very okay education in Russia. I was really much surprised why these people, you know, had a very good education. And we're talking, I mean, some people was from Columbia with a 4.0 GPA, you know, it's a fantastic GPA and it's a fantastic university. And those people used to come to day trading, you know, they said, listen, we can always go back, do what we were thought to do after college, but, you know, we can try, maybe, you know, this is much better for us. And in 1998, as I came to the firm, my firm probably was the only one firm which was specializing in the day trading and on the New York Stock Exchange. My boss, my ex-boss, Walter Bruin, used to build the rules, and the rules was just the New York Stock Exchange and just the day trading. So when we started asking the first question, you know, why the New York Stock Exchange, the answer was very simple. First of all, you can protect your risk, because you put in the stops, and the stops go with the specialist, and the specialist must execute the order. And second thing, it's much easier to understand one player, because, you know, it used to be in the 90s and in the mid-2000s, used to be one player, and that player was a specialist who run one stock, And it's much easier to understand one player than to understand a bunch of my market makers. Just for you to understand, today on Microsoft alone, we're talking about hundreds of market makers. So he said that if you run, if one person is running one stock, it's much easier to understand one person. So basically, we were thought that we would trade only New York Stock Exchange and only day trading. My first my first trade towards the holding the position I did in 2001. So what I figured out, when you start a day trade, you know one thing for a fact: end of the day, you have to close your position. So you know you open your position, let's say at any time during the day, you know, and some of my holdings was 15 seconds, 20 seconds. Sometimes I hold the stock for 2 hours, 3 hours, 5 hours, 7 hours, 6 hours, and I usually, the rule in a company was you have to sell the stock before 4 o'clock, no matter what it is, 3:59, 3:58, but it's got to be sold. So I remember in 2001, we had a problem with the internet, because you should understand, we're talking about just, you know, the beginning of the internet era, and it was not like right now. You know, you have internet everywhere. You take any single device and you press it and you have internet right there and everything is flying. You know, those years, the company used to pay $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 a month just for the good internet. You know, and we're talking about the thousands of traders and everybody going through the same hub. So very important thing would happen. One day, let's say, I'm about to close the position at like 3:58, and I had probably 6 or 7 position. You know, I was always a trader who trades a lot of the position. In our company, it was a bunch of different people. Everybody trade different way. Some people trade one position, but very large quantity. And some traders used to trade many stocks, but not a big quantity. I was the second category. I never trade one stock, but then big quantity, because you put every all the risk in one basket, and I never liked that. I would trade many different stocks, but with a limited number of risk. So, you know, one day, 3:58, I'm about to close my position, and I can't close my position for one simple reason, because, you know, we had a problem with internet collapse. Thank God in that time, our boss was very understandable, and there was a technical issues in the company, especially for those people who was making a lot of money, and I was one of them. I was a top producer, top grossing trader in the company. So everybody would get reimbursed. So, you know, I remember 3:58 and I have like 6, 7 position. I can't close the position. So I come to the risk management and said, listen, you know, I come to the risk manager and explain there is a problem. I cannot close my position because of the internet issue. So he said, listen, you know, don't worry about it. Next morning, we'll see what's going to be. If you're going to lose, we're going to reimburse, because, you know, I used to pay a lot in commissions. You know, in a few years I paid over $2 million just in commissions to the company. So even if the company would reimburse me $10,000 or $15,000, it wouldn't be a big deal. So, you know, I left with the position. You know, I was not even worried about, because, you know, I knew if something goes wrong, I will get reimbursed. So, you know, I come next morning and there's a gap down, you know, and I pretty much, I'm just for you to understand, I'm a trader who does about 80% of a short trade. So, you know, I like the short. Speed of the short trades is almost one, almost two times. Actually, in the industry, it's about 1.8 times faster than a long speed and a long trade. So, you know, it's I have 6 or 7 shorts, and the next day the market is opening lower, and I have $10,000 or $15,000 right away in profit. So, you know, I started to figure it out, and I always, from that point, I started to do homework for the swings. I never before trade the stocks that I hold the stocks, let's say, for months, like investors do. But, you know, I always did swings. So what I used to do, and I used to buy or sell stocks and wait until the next levels. So, for example, as I traded before only technicals, and I trade, still trading right now. And when I trade swing trades, I always use technical analysis. I never use like some indicators, Fibonacci or anything else. I always use either just the technical levels or ATR. You know, I always figure it out the way the stock trade, I mean, what's the stock can go to. And in these levels, you know, I will probably most of the time get out. So, you know, from that point of time, it was in 2001, I started to do mixed trading. You know, some trades I used to do intraday. And if I see the stock close in the right pace for me, I would hold the stock overnight. What is the right pace? For example, if you have levels and you, let's say, watching the stock by the levels, you can hold the stock on overnight. So what I used to do, let's say I trade the stock and there's a 10 or 15 minutes left. Obviously, you know, I deposit more money with the company. I ask for permission and I said, listen, I'll take my own risk. So I put enough money to start taking small position in the beginning. And then I figure it out. This is a very right way to do it. Thank God, actually, that I started to do that, because in 2008, 2010, going further, most of my trades was already swing trades, you know, because you cannot day trade all the time. Obviously, there's a lot of questions been going on with the people asking, what should I start with? Should I start with the intraday? Should I start with the swings? My answer is very simple. If you have a time and watch the stock for the intraday, you can do it, start with the intraday. I want you to understand one thing, which is a very important thing to understand. All the styles and all the trading positions, they depend just on one thing, on your psychological level and your system as a person. Some people cannot, they trade for one simple reason, because they cannot assume this tick by tick problems. For example, just for you to understand, you know, when you're a day trader, you can have 10, 20, 30 different positions. It means, since you're not trading all of this position in whole, you know, as a general, you trade this position totally separated one by one. And every time you trade one single position, you are having a problem. You take this one single position and put it through your system. That's the major problem. So not everybody can survive. Usually the expectancy life of a day trader itself, not too long, you know, 5-10 years, then the people are getting burned out. So in this case, you gotta start to do swing trades. What is the swing trades? We're talking about, let's say, you hold position overnight and probably until 3 to 5 days. Before, you know, I had a position 3 to 5 days, sometimes 7 days. You know, now, if I really like the stock, I can, hold a position for a long time. But you know, we're talking about the, there is an intraday trader, there is a swing trader, you'll say overnight into 7 days, and there's a investor. Investors are totally different. They, some investors go for the value. For example, they want to buy a stock at $1 and sell it to $3, buy at $3, sell at $20. And there's some investors who is investing into the dividend stock, either preferred stock or just the dividend company, or just the stocks which is paying a large dividends. Just for you to understand, there's a certain companies in the United States, preferred stocks paying 7, 7.5, and sometimes even more, over 8% on annual dividends. And this company has been paying dividends for the last 20 years. So before you choose, you have to figure it out for yourself. If you're gonna have a lot of trades, are you gonna be able to sustain so many trades together? Or let's say if you're an average guy and trading just enough stocks, you're gonna trade stocks with a large move for the future. What I want to show right now, I'm going to show you my computer, so you'll see. I want to show you some stocks and just explain what basically I'm doing. Why would I hold some stocks overnight or why not? So this is just for you to understand. This is just a daily chart, just a random stock. This is FCX, copper company, and just for you to understand. For example, we have a very strong level of $16 a share. You see, that's the level. We had a false breakout, second false breakout, third false breakout, and right now we can see the stock is trying to go to the $16. So, you know, intraday trader is going to try, let's say, to buy somewhere at the $15.50, sell at the $16, maybe even higher. But if you're a swing trader, you're not going to buy here for one simple reason, because you don't need this such a short move, and there is a very big resistance level at the price of the 16. So it's no reason for you to buy the 15.50 and sell it at 16, because you're definitely going to have a resistance there. So what the swing trader will do, swing trader will definitely wait for the price of 16. And then if the price of the 16 is going to sustain, and if the price is going to stay higher above the 16, then you can hold the overnight position. I will show you just a few stocks just for you to understand. Very important thing you have to figure it out, where the stock is going and what you're supposed to do. Okay, what do we have here? Just for you to understand, we have a big gap, right? After the gap, the most important thing, if the stock is turning back or not. But you should understand one thing. For example, you figure it out a very important level right here, like it will close. So you'll understand why is it level. As you see, the level is as a limit buyer, you see, the price is 850, and they're not letting this person out of the stock. They're basically holding the stock, and they're not letting this guy to go any lower. So you know one thing for a fact, for example, how to trade the stock. You know, you cannot trade the stock intraday because there's not a lot of volatility, not enough volatility. But you know one thing for a fact, if the price of a $9 a share, $8.80, is going to be broken, then you know one thing for a fact, this is a stock is an extremely good candidate for the a drop down and for the overnight holding. So for example, look at this. You have a next day, you see the stock not only broke the low, but it's as well, it's closed down a lower low. So you know one thing for a fact, there is a big seller in it. So you definitely hold the position again. And that's how you go. You go start day by day, day by day, day by day. So what it is, you know one thing for a fact, you hold that particular stock until that stock, for example, right here, try to make a turnaround and they kick you out. But you know, in this case, you already made almost $3 on the $8 stock is almost 40%. So that's how you trade. If the position will allow you, you see, right now the stock is going to $1.99. So what we have today, take a look. If this stock, the name of the stock is CRXRX Concordia International, if the stock is going to be able to hold down today below $1.99, then the stock has all the chances to go lower. You see, if the stock is going to go lower, then basically you have to hold the stock for the overnight position. This is a very important thing. See, take a look. So what I want to tell you, what I wanted to tell you, if you have a position where the stock is shown to you either weakness, either basically a strength above certain levels, this will give you a very clear and good idea of what to do with the stock. Should you hold the stock overnight, or should you basically take the stock and just to do intraday trade? For example, when this position is going to be intraday and when this position is going to be hold overnight. For example, very important thing. First of all, what do we have to say? We have to say the low of that bar. Low of that bar was $1.98, so basically you should have the position. But if the closing of the stock is going to be above $2 right here, then the stock has all the chances basically to come back. So the stock is cannot go lower, especially there is not a lot of volume. So in this case, very important thing, my friends, it's to see what the stock is going to do. If it's going to come back at over $2 a share, then the stock has all the chances basically to pull up. And if the stock is going to be still holding below $2, then the stock has all the chances to die. This is just the one example. Let me give you a few different examples. Take a look at the stock EARS. You know, very funny name. Everybody who is watching us, they know, you know, what the EARS means. So, you know, I don't know what the company do. I never basically tried to figure it out and go into the fundamentals of the stock. I tried to figure it out one thing. For me, the chart. So we have a very crucial level right here. At the low of this level is $1.02, just to show it to you, $1.02. You know, for example, for now, if you got at the high price, you know, you still hold in the position because basically the picture is not changing. So the very important rule of hold or not to hold the position, it's when basically position done or it's not done. So in this case, you hold the stock, but very important thing, how the stock is going to behave below $1.02. If the stock is going to hold below $1.02, basically the stock has all the chances to go to 50 cents, even lower. Take a look what was before. It tests the low, you know, the low was 83 cents. Then basically it pulled back higher and now it's coming back. So most likely there is no buyers in the stock and the stock is going to get destroyed. So the very important thing is to watch out for the level 102. If the level 102 is going to be broken and sustained, then the stock has all the chances to die. I just showed to you some little tricks about what you should do. I mean, just for you to understand, if you want a nice, simple, quiet life, you should probably stick with the swing trading. If you want some crazy stuff and make money fast, it's intraday, because in intraday you can really make crazy percent, because you know, turnaround of the money, it's extremely big. So the very important thing for you to figure it out, it's what exactly you want. If you're a nice quiet guy, most likely the intraday trading is not going to be good enough for you. If you are a trader who basically understands the game, then probably you have to stick with the swings. Anyway, it's been Alexander Gurchik, and one more time I wanted to let you know that in end of March, in the company of Gurchik & Company, in our company, it's the competition starts for the Tima Traders account. The most important thing, you work on demo account, and if you show good results, you get in a real money on the Tima account under management. So the most important thing, if you show good results, you get $1,000 in the Tima account. But the most important thing, you don't take any risk, because this is a demo account. I want to thank you very much. If you have any questions, please sign those questions, watch our videos. You know, I'm a professional trader with a 20 years of experience. In 2016 was 20 years that I've been in the industry. So trust me, you know, you have a lot to learn. And if you have questions, please ask me. A professional trader, you can check the CRD or anything else. I made millions of dollars in trading, real millions of dollars. So if you have a chance, please ask me a question. I'll be more than happy to answer. And it's been Alexander Gurchik from Gurchik & Company. And all the best. And one more time, Happy New Year. Trade and make money. Thank you very much.